Sometimes electrical signals are not very big. They may have been provided by something that does not generate much power, and they may have traveled long distances, or maybe they were buried in a noisy signal so that they're hard to detect. In any of these cases, we will likely need to make the electrical signal bigger before we can use it. Making a signal bigger is called amplification. We should probably begin by defining signals. A signal is an indication of something. For example, wind is an indication of differences in air pressure. A light on in an empty room may signal an impending tirade from Dad about the electric bill. An electrical signal is just a special case of signals. According to thefreedictionary.com, an electrical signal is an impulse or fluctuating electric quantity, such as a voltage, current, or electric field strength whose variations represent coded information. Some electrical signals are obvious, such as the data stream that contains this video. Others may be more subtle, like sensor information revealing the slight variations in the Earth's magnetic field. In either case, there's information that we want to preserve, transmit, and possibly amplify. For our purposes today, I'm going to limit the topic to basic analog amplifiers. These are amplifiers that take a time-varying signal and increase some aspect of that signal, often the amplitude of its voltage. To make it a little more concrete, let's take the example of a sound system. Sound is converted to an electrical signal by a transducer called a microphone. The signal will then be amplified by an amplifier and output to another transducer called a speaker, which converts the amplified electrical signal to sound. Since the title of this video is Amplifiers, our focus is going to be on the amplifier. However, I should mention a few things about the microphone and speaker. There are many types of microphones: condenser microphones, ribbon microphones, carbon microphones, piezoelectric microphones, and many others. Each type of microphone has very different properties, both from an acoustic standpoint and an electrical standpoint. If I don't specify what type of microphone the system will use, the variation of the electrical properties can be very large. That being said, we do know one thing: the microphone serves as a source and will be modeled by some sort of Thevenin equivalent circuit. Speakers also have a lot of variation in the properties they can have. Speakers can have a large impedance. Impedance is like resistance, only it applies to signals that vary in time. Or very small impedance. But either way, a speaker looks something like an equivalent resistance. And of course, the amplifier has an equivalent circuit too. If we were to model a generalized amplifier, it would look like this. If that is our model for an amplifier, we have three basic quantities we're interested in: the resistance of the amplifier at the input, the amount of amplification the amplifier provides, that will be the gain of the dependent source, and the resistance of the output of the amplifier. Rather than analyze an amplifier that we don't yet understand, let's make up some properties of an amplifier. And since we're making things up, we might as well make it as perfect as possible. Beginning at the input, what properties would be ideal? As far as the amplifier is concerned, we have one parameter: input resistance. Remember that from the perspective of a source, we're interested in what type of load we're supplying. If we attach an arbitrary source to this circuit, we see that the input voltage to the amplifier can be determined using voltage division. Looking at the voltage division equation, for all of the signal from the source to get to the input of the amplifier, the input resistance of the amplifier would have to be infinite. Since getting the entire input signal into the amplifier is desired, the ideal amplifier would have an infinite input resistance. Onto the output section of the amplifier. If we attach an arbitrary load resistance to the output of our model, we can see that the output voltage or load voltage can be determined by using voltage division. However, this time the amplifier model has two properties: a voltage gain and an output resistance. If we look at the equation for the voltage divider again, we see the output resistance of the amplifier is in the denominator and can only take away from the amount of signal that reaches the output. That being the case, it would be better if it were not there. No, I'm not talking about you. Why are you so sensitive all the time? Oh, guess I kind of understand. Sorry. Anyway, the ideal case then is that the output resistance of the amplifier would be zero. What about the gain of the dependent source? Well, that may be a little more abstract. In an ideal amplifier, we would get something at the output no matter how small the input signal might be. The smallest signal I could think of would be something like this. The input voltage never quite gets to zero, but does become vanishingly small. In order to get any output voltage in this case, there's only one possible value for the gain of the dependent source, and that is infinity. So an ideal amplifier would have an infinite input resistance and gain, along with no output resistance. Certainly, no such amplifier exists, but let's pretend that it does. How would a circuit that contains it behave? Here is a circuit that contains an ideal amplifier. Well, the first thing we might consider in the circuit is that with an infinite input resistance, no current goes into the input of the amplifier. And if there is no current going into the terminals, and those terminals are connected through some resistance internally, then there cannot be any voltage difference between those terminals. And if there's no voltage difference between those terminals, since the bottom terminal is grounded, then the top pin also has to be at 0 volts. If we keep in mind that the output model has a voltage source with infinite gain and no output resistance, the output can be pretty much anything, so I'll just call it Vload. Choosing directions for the current through the two resistors connected to the top input of the amplifier, we can write the node voltage equation. This equation has only one unknown, so we can solve it directly. Multiplying through by 10 kiloohms and rearranging, we get that the output voltage is the negative of the ratio of the 10 kiloohm resistor and the 1 kiloohm resistor at the input times the input voltage. So that for a 1 volt input, we would get negative 10 volts at the output. Alright, so that's what would happen with a perfectly ideal amplifier. Teachers are always doing that. They give you an example that's all crafted and perfect with easy numbers and save the hard problems for you, usually on an exam. Of course, that was just an academic exercise, right? Well, let's find out. If we replace the ideal amplifier with a model of an imperfect amplifier and perform the same analysis, what would we get? Here's the same exact circuit, except I've substituted in an imperfect model for the amplifier. Rather than have an infinite input resistance, we have 100 kiloohms. Rather than an infinite voltage gain on the dependent source, we have a gain of 10,000 volts per volt. And instead of 0 ohms for an output resistance, we have 100 ohms. I think we can agree that these numbers do not represent ideal values, as they do not consist of infinities and zeros. Let's see what we get. Let's use node voltage analysis to analyze this circuit. So we start by selecting a reference node. Then we have two nodes that are defined by voltage supplies. The remaining two nodes are defined by our unknown voltages. We can assign directions to each of the currents, and then we can write the KCL equation at the left-hand node. Currents entering the node equal the currents leaving the node. Therefore, the current through the 1 kiloohm resistor plus the current through the 100 kiloohm resistor equals the current through the 10 kiloohm resistor. At the right-hand node, we have the current through the 10 kiloohm resistor plus the current through the 100 ohm resistor equals the current through the 1 kiloohm resistor. With two equations and two unknowns, we can start with some algebra. We can multiply through the left-hand equation by 100 kiloohms. The right-hand equation can be multiplied through by 10 kiloohms. Combining terms results in the following two equations. Solving the right-hand equation for Vin, we can then substitute that value into the left-hand equation, resulting in this. We solve for Vload, we find the output voltage is negative 9.98769 volts. And yes, those are way too many significant figures.
Rounding to 0.1 volts gives
negative 9.99 volts. And even this number probably has too many significant figures. For those of you who are suffering from short-term memory issues, the result we got from the ideal amplifier was negative 10 volts. Now stay with me here. Using our model of the ideal amplifier, our analysis took one equation and three steps. Using a non-ideal model of an amplifier, the analysis took an entire page of equation and resulted in a difference of about 1%. To me, that seems like a lot of work for no return, especially when we consider that the resistors we're using often have a 5% tolerance. What that tells us is that if we can find an amplifier that has the properties we used in the model or better, then we should be able to substitute the ideal model for the amplifier rather than use the non-ideal model when we perform the analysis and still get very reasonable results. If only there were such an amplifier. Well, guess what? The numbers I put into the non-ideal model were numbers I got from a data sheet for a very common operational amplifier. And really, I didn't even use the numbers from the data sheet. I took the worst case numbers from the data sheet and rounded them to even worse values so that the math would work out better. Even better, most operational amplifiers have better properties than the one I used. Now, I do have to point out that part of the reason this worked out so well is because of the size of the resistors that are placed around the amplifier. The two 1 kiloohm resistors and the 10 kiloohm resistor are very reasonable values, and are values of resistance that we would typically use with an operational amplifier. But if I had chosen 1 mega ohms and 10 mega ohms, my results would not have been so close to ideal. I only mention this to say there are some limitations to the ideal model. Most of these limitations, however, will not be dealt with in this series. In this series, we will use the ideal model of the operational amplifier with only some basic limitations. In this video, we went over the properties of an ideal amplifier. We determined that an ideal amplifier would have an infinite input resistance, an infinite voltage gain, and no output resistance. We then analyzed an ideal amplifier circuit and a non-ideal amplifier circuit and found the results we got were comparable. Now we have identified an amplifier with the properties that match the non-ideal, almost ideal model parameters. That is, the operational amplifier. With the operational amplifier identified and its ideal properties identified, next time we'll take a look at some of the circuits we can make with an operational amplifier. Thanks for watching. Till next time, go out and make it a great one.